one of my favorite psalms is make a joyful noise to the Lord, so we're gonna do that tonight. You with me?
I like turtles.
With the rising of the sun, I will praise you. Woo. And at the setting of the same, it shall go on. Hey. Now you've given me joy. You've given me
turtles.
Freedom.
Before they get out of here, they're coming back, don't worry. But can we say thank you to these guys for all they've done all week long? I don't know if you know everybody, but we got Daniel way over there who's leaving. Christian just go off stage, and Brian's, they're like turning their backs on me, and Kaylee and Isaiah and Brooks, and Natalie who leads the whole crew. Let's hear for them one more time. Come on. Why are they doing that? Go, go, go. Y'all might want to go have a seat. We got a couple things to do here. Don't worry, you will have a chance to come back up right here. And while you're on your way, let's pipe down for just a moment. Let's pipe down. You can walk and be quiet at the same time. It's not hard, I promise. But you're not. That's okay. Hey, so we got a lot to celebrate tonight. I mean, we don't I don't really want to like celebrate the fact that it's our last night at camp. That's like a boo, but that's okay. We kind of got to get home to the mommies and daddies and brothers and sisters. But we do have a lot of great stuff tonight to celebrate. I want to start with two just sort of random celebration kind of things. Number one is, where's Taylor Kinsey? Where's Taylor Kinsey? Where's Taylor? Where's Taylor? Where's Taylor Kinsey? I can't see. Is he over there? Okay, so Taylor, I can't see you, but I can hopefully hear you. Where did you spend all day today? Taylor, how many times did you go down the slide today? How many? Taylor Kinsey went down the slide 50 times today. Unbelievable. It is another Akoi record broken. So celebrate that. Way to go, Taylor. Hey, and where's Paul Gonka? Paul's one of our leaders. Where's Paul? Hey, Paul. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to Paul Gonka. I don't know if it's anybody else's birthday, but it might be. So, hey, I got some other people. You know, lots of times when you are kind of winding down a camp like this, there's a lot of folks you really should kind of say thank you to, because so much goes in to putting this together. So I'm just going to like reel off a group of people. Number one is our medical team, who have kind of been taking care of you all week long. They're pretty darn awesome. Don't forget our safety team, who's been kind of keeping us safe every night from the Sarah Squarch. You probably don't know this person, but Michelle Hoffman, we just want to say thank you to you. You've been amazing back there. She's been incredible. We showed you the picture of this room, what it looked like, you know, before we came in. So we got to say thanks to all these guys back here for what they've done. And here's the crazy thing is, probably by like 3 a.m., the room will be back to normal. And because they'll be in here tonight kind of breaking it down. Mike already talked about all of our small group leaders, but I got to say thank you to all of you guys and everybody who's here kind of just helping every single week. And, you know, for me, I get a chance to work with some absolutely amazing people who are on staff at our church. And so Jonathan in New Bern, right? Let's say Jonathan, way to go, and lead that crew. And Matt Rabelais in Leland, most excelente, right? Not on staff where the husband is, but Megan Klaus, where are you and the Jacksonville girls? Where are y'all? Just give us a little whoop whoop. Yeah, Megan, thanks for bringing them, right? Of course, you know, Brett Eddy, who's kind of been doing tons and tons around here, right? She doesn't come up here on stage, but Pat Connolly, everybody knows Mama Pat. She's stinking amazing, right? We've already talked about Kyle Van Zandt and him leaving, boo, but we love Kyle. Thanks, Kyle Van Zandt. Let's hear for him. Hey, and we did this with our leaders this morning. You know, we got to say, I don't know if all of you know this, but a couple of ladies who've been working as interns for a couple years, Maddie Mankowski and Kaylin Johnson. We love them. They're both moving on to some other stuff, and we can't talk them into not doing that. But anyway, we wanted to say we love you girls, and thank you so much. And we should probably say thanks to Mike Ashcraft for being here this week. Right? We should do that. And you know what? I think I got everybody. Yeah. Okay, so. Here's what you got to do. Stop. Here's what you got to do. You got to know that there's a...
What about Chris Sasser?
Sure. People who have control of the microphones can do that to you. Here's what you got to know. After tonight, you're going to go straight back to your cabins. We're telling you all this now because we don't want to come up at the end of the night and give you some announcements, but... At the end of the night, there's no late night. It's just you having an opportunity to be with your small group in your cabin, have some great conversations. But you also have to kind of start the cleanup process because we're leaving in the morning early, right? And so here's what the camp has asked you to do. And by the way, unbelievable job of helping to clean up out there on that field when we were done. That was amazing, right? And we got another day's reports from the Akoi staff about how great you guys have been out on the activities. So thank you for doing that. Let's finish strong, okay? Finish strong with cleaning up your cabins. And what they're asking is, specifically, they said, if you could take all of the, like, any water bottle or juice bottle, anything that's a bottle that's got liquid in it, pour it out into the sink. And then all of that goes into trash bags, and then trash bags get tied up really nicely, and they go out on the porch. Don't put them out tonight. They told us this. Don't put them on the porch tonight because animals do live in the woods, and they like trash. But in the morning before you leave, make sure you're putting your bags on the porch. Now, here's the time frame for tomorrow morning. The buses hopefully are going to come rolling in here at about 7 a.m. Ha ha ha, you love that, because you're going to sleep all the way home. It'll be fine. And we're going to try to send a couple of buses. The boys' buses up there, and you're going to put your luggage on that. We're going to try to send the girls' buses up that way, and you're going to put your luggage on that. Those of you who are in Lakeview and Poplar, we're going to send trucks to get your luggage, but you'll have to walk across, okay? So the hope is that you'll kind of get your luggage on the bus as fast as possible. Come down here. We'll have breakfast at 7:30-ish before we leave, and then the plan is to bring the buses down here to pick you up and then kind of get on out of here. So make sure you're cleaning up. We got the bottles, got the trash, got all that, yes. And it's our last night at Fuse. These guys are going to, not yet, going to lead us in a few more minutes, but I think I'm done. I've talked too much. I think I'm done.
Thank you.
Searching for answers far and wide.
Let's pray together. God, we're grateful for the adoption that you've brought us into your kingdom, into your family, that we are called your sons and daughters. And we rest in that identity tonight as we close out Fuse, God. Pray that we would go from this place remembering that you're with us, that the power of your Holy Spirit lives within us. And I pray that as your word is brought one more time tonight, God, you would speak as only you can. It's in your name that we pray and sing, Jesus. Amen. Thanks for singing with us. You can have a seat.
All right, we just sang, I'm no longer a slave to fear because I'm a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear because I'm a child of God. And the question that comes to my mind is, what does being a child of God have to do with not being a slave to fear? There are very few things that I love as much as my girls. I have two girls. One has just left to go back to Wilmington earlier today, and the other one is here. There are very few things that move me at the level that my girls do, touch my heart in places that I did not know existed. And I remember when my oldest daughter was really small. I'm gonna tell you some stories because I want you to get this father, this image in your head. What does being a child of God have to do with not being a slave to fear? And so I remember taking them into the ocean. When you would walk out with them, they would see the waves and immediately go, oh my gosh, this is too much for me. I can't do this. And there would be this overwhelming sense of fear that you're going into this thing that's unknown. You're not really sure how far you can go. You're not sure if you're going to live if you go out far. And I would grab a hold and say, come with me. Come with me. And I would start to walk them out. And she'd say, but Daddy, I'm afraid. I said, well, just look at me. Come with me. And as I had her in my arms, nothing in the circumstances changed. Nothing about what she had seen changed. The only thing that was any different from what she felt fear of standing there 2 seconds before versus being in my arms was that she was in the arms of a good, good father. I am no longer a slave to fear because I am in the arms of a good, good father. I've had many questions from you guys saying, but what if my dad isn't like that? We sang a song a few minutes ago, and it says, I've heard thousands of stories about what people say that you're like, but I've heard your voice whisper to me in the dead of night, telling me that you love me and telling me that I'm not alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And what? I am loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. I am loved by you. It's who I am. And my question to you is, can that really make all the difference in the world? And what did God do to make it so? He says that we love because he first loved us. In other words, I have to somehow encounter God's love, have that love formed in my heart, and then turn and express that love to other people. That's how the cycle works. I encounter his love for me in a way that is real and deep and true. And in that love, it forms my heart, and then I turn and express that love. And what I would tell you is this, if you're here and you long for the love of your earthly father, what you are longing for is your longing for God. Every longing at its core is a longing for life. And Christ is that life. You want to be right with God. That's what the longing always is. That's what it always is. No matter what kind of pressure you're feeling, that's what the longing always is. Can we get this fog to stop, like at some level? This is going to drive me nuts. I can't see anybody anymore. Is that yes or no? All right, perfect. Thank you. So when I was a kid, I'm going to have to come in here so I can see y'all again. When I was a kid, there, I can see y'all now. I was a pretty good kid, and we had a water heater in our basement. We had a basement in our house. We had a water heater in it, and there was a little flame in the bottom of the water heater. What this flame did, there was a little gas that blew through, and the flame kept it lit, and so I don't know how it worked exactly, but basically, the flame kept the gas moving, and it would light the and heat the water. That's how it worked, or something like that. And the only thing I knew that is you don't blow out the pilot light. You don't blow out the little flame. That was the command, thou shalt not blow out the flame. And you know what happens when you tell a 9-year-old, don't blow out the flame? I was like, I didn't even think about blowing out the flame. And now that's all I can think about is blowing out the flame. And so I heard rumors that if you blow out the flame, it would blow up the house. But I wasn't sure if that was true. So I looked at it. And it went out. It's like, uh-oh. So I'm waiting for the house to blow up. Well, the house didn't blow up immediately, but because my brothers went and told on me. And when you're the middle kid, you can't point to anybody else because they both point at you every single time. You know how this works. So we come down stairs, and Dad starts the inquisition. And he lines us all up and says, y'all need to tell who did it. We all pointed at each other. And I resolved, I'm not telling him, because if the house blows up, this is not going to be on me. I'm not telling anybody ever. I will go to my grave with this secret. And so I looked at my dad, and he said, Mike, did you blow out the pilot light? I said, no, Dad, I did not blow out the pilot light. Mike, both your brothers telling you, Dad, prove it. I didn't say that. I said, Dad, I promise I did not blow out the pilot light. And he said, okay. And he sent us all away. Now, what do you think happened to me? I go up to my room. I'm trying to go on with life as normal, but I know that something is tragically wrong. And so that night at dinner, we sit down, and my parents cook us our favorite meal. They cook us piggies and blankets. It's sausage stuffed in potatoes with some kind of red sauce. It's so good. And so I'm sitting there, and I'm eating, and I'm playing with my food, and all I can think about is the fact that I blew up the pilot light, and I told my dad that I didn't. And so I imagine Dad says, Mike, it's your favorite meal. Are you enjoying it? Yeah, Dad, it's really good. And like everything in me is trying to enjoy what's going on, but something is tragically wrong because the only thing I can think of is the fact that I blew up the pilot light and I told my dad that I didn't. And so my dad's cool, my brothers are cool, and I'm like dying. I'm dying. I'm 9 years old and I'm dying. So I think maybe if I can just go to sleep, I'll sleep it off and I'll wake up tomorrow and it'll all be better. So I lay down, I think I go to bed at like 9 o'clock, 9:30, lay down, I'm trying to go to sleep, and guess what I'm thinking about? The stinking pilot light and my dad. So about 11 o'clock at night, and you don't wake my dad up. You don't do that. He goes to bed, you don't wake him up. So it's 11 o'clock. He's been in bed for like an hour and a half, maybe 12 o'clock by this time. He's been in bed for a long time. He's sound asleep. I think, I can't live with myself any longer. And what I believe is he's a good, good father. What I realized was that what I had done did not affect him at all, but it broke our relationship. It did something in us that I couldn't enjoy the things that I always enjoyed because they just didn't seem the same when something was so wrong. And so I went into his room and woke him up and I said, Dad, I blew out the pilot light. You can kill me now. And he said, oh, I know. And he looked at me and he said, I forgive you, we're right, we're good. And it was this weight of the world that came off of my shoulders. Not that what I had done wasn't wrong anymore, but that somehow what I had done did not separate me from him. And it was all going to be okay. Sometimes that's all you need is to realize that it's all going to be okay. The old system that God initiated when the whole thing began was, keep the commandments and I'll bless you. And we as stinking, stubborn human beings think that's a good deal. And he says, don't blow out the pilot light. And the only thing you can think about is you want to blow out the pilot light. And some of the commands you even break, you didn't even know were commands. And all of a sudden you realize this is not good news. Keep the commands and I'll bless you is a terrible thing for us because we simply can't do it. None of us can do it. And so some of you are stuck working harder and harder. That's why I talked about these two paths, right? The first path over here is this path of high performance, and the second path over here is this path of the least resistance. And maybe it works itself out for you like this, that the idea of having a religion, and I hate the term religion. I don't believe in religion because religion is, what can I do to get God to accept me? What can I do to get to God? And so some of you, that's the track you're on, and you know that you're on this track when you say things like this. I don't feel like I'm doing enough. That's the pressure that comes from trying to live out God's expectations of you or what you think he expects of you, because somehow you think that if you do enough, God will accept you more. And so your whole mantra is, I don't think I'm doing enough. Or you say that what I have done is so bad that he'll never accept me. If you say those two things, you are on track one. Track two says this, and the pressure from track one is, I am not doing enough, right? Track two is this. Track two says, well, what does it matter anyway? There might not even be a God. In fact, I don't even care if there's a God. And the pressure in this is that it doesn't matter anyway. And it doesn't seem like pressure because it seems like when something doesn't matter, that it shouldn't matter. But when something doesn't matter, it becomes futile. And that's even worse because then you can't make sense of anything. And so you're stuck there. And you know this when you constantly just sort of throw your hands up and say, well, it doesn't matter, it doesn't matter, it doesn't matter. That's track two. And here's what I want you to understand. Either way, you have faith in you. Over here, you think that if you do enough, you'll be right. And over here, what you think is the foundation of all. And so you're trusting what you think. And either way, you are trusting in yourself. And neither one of them work. They are pressure that your soul can't handle. And you can't bear the weight of it. The foundation of you is not enough. And so there's a third way. And that way is the gospel. And the gospel isn't what do you do for God. It's that God came to you where you are to make sure that you are made right with him once again. That's what Jesus said to us, that if we abide in his word, right? If we abide in his word, we are his disciples, and we will know the truth, and the truth will set us free. And I thought, what does it mean to abide in God's word? And a lot of you believe that to abide in God's word means to keep all of his commands. And what I want to tell you is to abide in his word doesn't mean to keep his commands. It means to trust what he says. Those are different things. I told this story yesterday with the middle school kids. We were talking about the commands, because the question was, do I have to keep the commands? And there was a ruler, a rich young man who came up to Jesus and said, Jesus, what do I have to do to inherit the kingdom of God? What do I have to do to get this thing that you're talking about? And Jesus looks at him and says, keep the commands. Now, if you're a believer, that's the wrong answer. Jesus gave this guy the wrong answer. You want the kingdom of God? Keep the commands. And the guy, because he's a good Jewish kid, says, I've kept them all since I was born. I've kept them my whole life. And Jesus said, there's one thing that you still lack. I want for you to sell all of your possessions and give them to the poor and come and follow me. Abide in my commands, in my word, and you will be my disciple. You will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. What is it that Jesus is? What are you trusting that he's saying? And the word is really simple. He says, come follow me. He says again, he says, come to me, all of you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest for your souls. Come to me, you can trust me with the pressures that you're under. Bring them to me. I can take them on. My yoke is easy. My burden is light. Come to me. He's not asking you to obey more rules. If you abide in his word, what he is saying is you are not just trying to obey all the commands. You are trusting what he says, that if you come to him, if you come to him, you will find rest for your souls. You will find the pressure that you were under begin to dissipate on the solid foundation of him. If the Son sets you free, you are free indeed. There's a verse that a lot of you might be familiar with. And for some of you, it's your favorite verse. And to be honest, it's a really good verse to be your favorite verse, especially if you like things to go your way. And the verse is Jeremiah 29:11. You know what it says? Yes, it's my favorite verse. I've got it on cross-stitched and on my Instagram account. It's on my phone, wallpaper, and all that cool stuff. I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and to give you a future. My question is, who doesn't like that verse? Like, if God promises to prosper you, I'm like, sign me up. That's what I wanted in college. Plan to prosper you, plans not to harm you, no harm. You'll never be hurt. Everybody loves that. These next two are really interesting. Plans to give you a hope. And a future. I began to reflect on this, and I thought, why do we love this verse so much? And the reason we love it is obvious. The reason we love it is because we like to be prosperous at low risk. I want to get everything the way it should be, and I don't want to take too much risk doing it. I want to be prosperous, and I don't want harm. I love this. These two are really interesting. Because let's start with future. What does it mean to be promised a future? It means there's always more. I've talked to many of you who are so nervous about your college education, where you're going to go to school, or maybe if you're going to play sports at this school. And I said, well, what if it doesn't work out the way you want it to? Guess what? There's always more. What if you get cancer at the age of 35 and don't live to be 38 like one of my friends, or 42 like one of my friends? Guess what? In Christ, there's always more. He has promised that there is a future for you. There is always more. That you don't come and say, that's the end of my life, because there's always more. We're going to talk about that in just a moment. But this one right here is what's really interesting. Do you know what hope requires? How many of you on Friday, when you were driving here, especially those of you who were stuck on the unair-conditioned bus for 12 hours, you were hoping this was going to be a good camp? In fact, you weren't just hoping. You were like, this had better be a good camp. You were hoping it was going to be a good camp. Now today, you don't hope it's a good camp anymore. Do you know why? Because you know it's been a good camp, right? Hope requires uncertainty. When you're on the bus and it's 108 degrees, you're going, I just want to go back to Wilmington. This camp, it better be awesome. You are hoping because you have no idea if you're even going to make it to camp, and if you do, is it going to be any good? You don't know, and so you begin to question because the bus is hot. I have questions, and I'm going to use my friend Matthew, but I have questions that say, Mike, what if I doubt? What if I have a hard time believing that God is really good, that he's faithful to me, and sometimes I put my faith in him and it feels real, and sometimes it feels like I'm not, and I'm not really sure, and sometimes I wonder if I believe enough. Sometimes I doubt. Does that mean I'm a bad person or a bad Christian, or that maybe I'm even going to hell? Where's my friend Matthew at? Matthew, are you here? My bubblegum? Matthew, come up here. I got something for you. So I told Matthew the other day, he asked me this question. Come on up here. Yo, it's Matthew. I just said that, didn't I? Matthew? This is Matthew. Woo! All right. I told Matthew, and I said to him, I said, Matthew, suppose, I said, I have something good for you. Suppose I have something good for you. I said, do you trust me enough to reach out and take it? And he said, yes. And you did what? And you put your hand out. And I said to you, right now, do you believe that I'm going to give you something good? And you said, yes. I said, do you have any doubts about it? And you said, yes. Why? Because I haven't given it to him yet. So he's standing up here right now hoping that I'm going to give you something good. And you're standing there looking like, may I please have what you have? Right? You look kind of goofy right now. You know that, right? So hold it up there. So what if I went, psych! Right? What happens? He's a middle schooler, so okay. No, I'm just kidding. So I do this again. I said, do you believe that I have something good for you? No, we ain't getting it then. Do you believe I have something good for you? Yes or no? Do you have any doubts? Yes. What if I told you it's a $20 bill? Did your doubts go up or down? Your doubts went up because it sounds too good to be true, doesn't it? So right now, he is standing up here. His hand extended is exactly what faith looks like. He has some doubts, but he ain't moving his hand because he thinks I might have a $20 bill for him. And so if I do this right there. No, it's yours, dude. It's not an option. A positive. Hey, show him it's a 20, Matthew. Matthew, show him it's a 20. It's a legit 20, right? It's a 20. Now, let me tell you what happens. Let me tell you what happens. You're good. You're good. Let me tell you what happens. Listen. What happens if I said, Matthew, do you need any faith that I'm going to give you a $20 bill? He says, no, I don't need faith because you already gave it to me. And what I want you to understand is that faith, the opposite of faith is not doubt. The opposite of faith is certainty. Once it has already happened, you no longer need, you don't need faith that yesterday was a good day. You need faith that tomorrow is going to be a good day. Because it requires uncertainty, and uncertainty is always intermingled with doubt. And you should never, ever, ever feel inferior in your faith because you have doubt, because faith exists precisely in the presence of doubt. Now, what you should feel inferior when you start to be scoffing, you ain't going to do that for me, God. That's different. But to say, God, this sounds too good to be true. Could it really be like this? That's faith. To walk up here, and here's the problem. Matthew, you feel like you're going to have to do something to pay me back for that. He even said, no, you can't do this. You can't give this to me. I need to do something back. No, you don't. It's free. It's yours. It's yours. You don't owe me anything. Do you believe that? You don't owe me anything. And you've got to get this, because what's going to happen is every time he sees you, he's going to go, oh, there's Mike. I need to do something nice for him because he gave me something. No, he doesn't. Owe me anything. Y'all, what God does for us sets us free. Free. Some of you have been trying so hard to get God to like do, and you're just, man, if I could do more, if I could believe harder, if I could just, and he's like, y'all, if the Son of Man sets you free, you are free indeed. Okay, that's what he does. That's what he does. The New Covenant. I want to read this to you. In Hebrews chapter 8, it says this. Start in 7. 7, verse 18. The former regulation, if you keep my commands, I'll bless you. And this is in the Bible. I'm not making this up. Has been set aside because it was weak and it was useless, for the law made nothing perfect. There was nothing that Matthew was going to do to be worth $20 to me in 3 minutes up here. Nothing. So all of his obedience to get this was never going to work. So instead, I just set that aside and looked and said, look, man, I'm going to do something for you that you could never do for yourself. And I just gave it to him. Because it is what gives him what he needs, what we need together. And he says, for the law made nothing perfect, and there is a better hope that is introduced by which we draw near to God. And then he talks about the new covenant in the next chapter. He said, there is a day that is coming when there will be a new covenant, and I will be their God, and they will be my people. And instead, what will happen is, I will put my law on their minds, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they will be my people. And there will no longer be any need to teach all this, because we will already be known fully as we are. And then he says, and I will forgive their wickedness, and I will remember their sins no more. In the tabernacle, in the temple system, it's really fascinating. What would happen is the priest would come into the temple, and there was no chair, no seating in the temple, because the priest was to always stand. And the priest would always stand, symbolizing that the work was never done. The work was never done. So that the priest would always go in and sacrifice on behalf of the people so that God would be their God and they would be his people and their sins would be forgiven. And this would happen on and on and on and on and on. And the priest would never sit down because the work was never done. And when Jesus comes, it says that he was the high priest, the final priest. And it says that when he made the final sacrifice of his own life and he came back, he says, now he's in the temple and he is sitting down. Do you know why? Because it is finished. There is no more work that needs to be done. Okay, nothing. Nothing. So what we have to do is learn how to trust that. We have to learn how to trust that. So I want to try, I'm trying to think about how I want to do this. So another kid's story. Because you go, okay, how do I trust this? What does this mean if I want to play sports or I want to go to school or I want to do things good? My daughter, Michaela, she was kind of like the tenacious one. She always wanted to do stuff. And so her thing was always, she always say, I can do it myself. That's what she's always say. And so she would say something like, I want to help you with the chores. So one day we were going to help take out the trash at the church. And so we were picking up the trash. It was a giant trash bag. And so I've got half of them. She says, I want to help you. I says, perfect, no problem, grab a hold of it. So she reaches up and she grabs a hold of the trash bag. And so then she looks at me and she says, I can do it myself. So I dropped it on her. And she's grabbing, and she's grabbing, and she's grabbing. And I said, hey, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and you'll find rest for your soul. And so I picked up the trash bag. She said, cool. And I said, cool. I picked up the trash bag, and she helped me take out the trash. You know what it's like to have a three-year-old help you take out the trash? It takes way longer than it would have if you just took it out yourself. And you think about this. We always talk about doing big things for God. Like, how much does God really need us to do big things? I mean, he like put Pluto out there, and we could barely find it. And he thinks he needs me to do big things for him. I think sometimes I'm like Michaela in the trash bag going, okay, God, this is pretty awesome. And what begins to happen is you realize that what he says is true. He says, I want you to do whatever you do, whether you eat or whether you drink, whether you play volleyball or softball or make good grades, or whether you enjoy reading or writing or living at the beach, whatever you do, do it for my glory. Someone said, Mike, if you don't think about God all the time, do you really love God? One of the highlights for me, my oldest daughter, Madison, when she was a junior in high school, had a little surgery on her face, and she had a really bad reaction to the anesthesia, and she it was very scary. She missed 40 days of school because she couldn't read anymore. She couldn't order her food at a restaurant. And we took her to doctors and, I mean, everywhere trying to figure out what was going on and found out some, you know, what it was. And eventually just through some time and such that she recovered and returned to normal after about 40 days. And in that time, she had a car wrecked her car. And I gave her a Honda CRV. Now, I didn't know this, but that was like her dream car at the time. And so when I gave it to her, she said, oh, Dad, thank you. I love it. Right? I love it. And it brought me such joy seeing her enjoy what I had given her. And whether or not she told me thank you every day, or whether or not she was like, Dad, I love the car. Every time someone said, I like your car, Dad gave it to me. Dad gave it to me. And it's not, you know, it didn't matter to me. What I loved was the fact that something inside of her enjoyed what I was giving her, and I found a tremendous amount of delight in her enjoying what I had given. I wonder sometimes if God's not like that. When you simply do something that you enjoy doing, and you receive it sort of this humble, God, thank you so much for letting me experience this. And even if you don't say it or think it or just, it's just sort of a pure thing. I wonder if it's not the same way. That if you love to play volleyball, and because you don't say, praise God every time you get a spike, or you pray, you know, I thought, how do I glorify my wife? To every 5 minutes, I could praise Julie. Just so you know, I'm married to Julie. No, I just live in a way that is faithful to the relationship that we have. That's what brings it glory. And for some of you, y'all, that's going to take the pressure off because you keep trying to make everything so spiritual or whatever. And sometimes it's just about you living the way God has entrusted you to live. He says, here you go. If I set you free, you are free indeed. But what we need isn't to do more. It's to trust that what he has done for us is enough. When my oldest daughter was 2, and I remember this like it was yesterday. When you become a father, lots of cool things happen. One is you sort of enter into this new domain, this realm of glory. And when I became a father and a husband, what I wanted more than anything else was my own recliner and remote control. And there's something about it that just feels like, yes, I am the king of the world. And so my daughter was 2, and she would drink milk out of these sippy cups. And we would put these sippy cups in the bottom of the refrigerator, and we would say, of any sippy cup on the bottom shelf, you may freely drink. But out of the milk jug in the center of the refrigerator, you cannot eat or drink, or you will surely die. That was the command. And so you know how this goes. It would go on for a while. And then one particular day, I was on the throne in all of my glory watching SportsCenter. And I could hear a little noise in the other room. And it goes, ksh. And I could hear the rummaging of some sippy cups on the bottom. And then I heard what sounded like a little soft clack that sounded like an empty sippy cup. And then I heard a foom. I thought, this does not sound good. And I sat there for a minute listening, and I could hear another little noise, and then I heard glook, glook. Glook, 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 glook. So I left my throne of glory, and I entered into the place, and what I saw was an entire gallon of milk spilled on a hardwood floor. It looked like the Atlantic Ocean. And she's standing in the middle of it. I didn't do it. In fact, what she then did, after she denied it, she went and tried to get some stuff to clean it up. And you know what happens when you smear milk around on a hardwood floor? It just moves in other places of the house. And at some point, she realized this was not going to get any better. And she turned and she looked at me and she says, oh, Dad. I said, come to me. And so she came, and I bent down, and I said, look, I asked you not to do this, and you did it. And it was a mess. She said, oh, I know. I said, I got this. And I set her to the side, and I went and I got like 4 rolls of paper towels, and I did for her what she could never do for herself. And the only thing she could do was just receive it. Now, when I finished cleaning everything up, I turned back around to find her, and she was gone. And so I walked back into her room, and she was standing in the corner, and she had put herself in timeout. And it broke my heart, because I thought, why do you not believe that what I did was enough? I'm a good, good father. I came to do for you what you could not do for yourself. And I said, what I have done is enough to make you right with me. You aren't acceptable to me because you think that you're acceptable. You're acceptable to me because I have chosen you, and you are acceptable to me. For some of you, you need to start to believe that and trust that. When Jesus says to you, come, me and Emma Poindexter and Lexi Poindexter, y'all in here? Sarah Gallimore, y'all in here? We shared an experience last Wednesday night, didn't we? Are y'all in here? Where are you at? We went to see Justin Bieber, didn't we? Where's Emma at? Is Emma even in here? All right, she's back there. She's good. So we were talking about Justin Bieber. I saw Justin Bieber live in concert. He was very good. Now, my seats were not as good as y'all's. And so Emma and I and Sarah were talking about the concert, comparing videos, because I've got videos of us videoing the concert, and hers were much closer than mine. And she said, "He looked at me." And she has a picture of Justin Bieber looking at her. She said, "He looks at me, and he looked at me, and he knows that I exist." And dude, it was like giggles. The God who made Justin Bieber, the God who made every single thing that you see or smell or hear or think or know or ever will know, sees you. And he knows that you exist. And not only does he know that you exist, he says, "I want you to come to me. I want you to come to me." Because you know what his invitation is? Some of you are scared to death about your future. And the pressure that you feel is just unbelievable because of your folks or school or sports or not knowing what you're supposed to be doing with your life. This is what he says. "I want you to cast your cares on me. Come to me. I am most careful with you. I see you, I know that you exist, and not only do I know that you exist, but I have come to you to invite you to come to me so that I could carry your burdens and that you could learn to believe that I am most careful with you." Now, here's what we're gonna do as we close our time out tonight, okay? And it's gonna be a little chaotic. We're gonna need you to kind of up your game just a little bit. We're gonna take communion together. And what communion is, it is a celebration of the new covenant. It is a celebration of the new covenant. It says, and for some of you who are here, you sang last week, right? A couple days ago, we said, "Sin defeated, we are free." You're like, "I'm not really sure that's true." What I'm asking you is, do you trust that Jesus is enough, that what he's done is enough for your sins? That's what the new covenant is. The old has been passed away because it never did what it needed to do, but the new covenant has made you holy and righteous and pure. And therefore, you are right with God, and you no longer need to do anything else to prove that. Just trust it, receive it, like Matthew did. And so maybe tonight you're going to do that. I want you to just think about that. For some of you, you've got all this pressure, and I ask at the end of the week, what's the pressure you feel? And I want you to wrestle with whether or not you're willing to take that pressure and to lay it on him, trusting that he is most careful with you. And so I'm going to pray for us. And then we're going to, the guys, I don't want everybody to move around. The band's going to be playing a little bit. But the guys are going to come. They're going to walk you. There's tables in the back, tables in the front. We're going to get this done really quickly. And then I'm going to come back. We're going to take this together. I'm going to give you some instructions on that. Because here's what I want you to do. You're going to take this as an act of faith. There might be doubts. That's fine. But you're going to take this as an act of faith. And then we're going to lead from that time into your small groups and help you do some things. We're going to mark these moments in some profound ways to help you remember them and apply them when you get back. So I'm going to pray, and then you guys can take them through communion. God, I just ask you to still our hearts right now. And God, as we wrestle, some in here are wrestling with big time decisions because the implications of their pressures are significant. God, I ask you to give us space for that to happen. God, I know that to be still sometimes is tough, and I just ask that you would just allow your presence to be enough for us in these moments and prepare us to trust. So God, I ask this in the name of your son. If you guys will go ahead and help them get this, we'll do this as quickly as we can. We'll be back together in just a few minutes. All right, are we ready? Everybody good? Okay. Two things. Yes. Not ready yet. Sorry. Thank you, Sass. Two things for tonight. Religion, right, is spelled D-O. What I'm going to do, what I need to do, I'm not doing enough. Irreligion is spelled D-O-E-S-N, apostrophe T, doesn't, as in it doesn't really matter anyway. But the gospel is spelled D-O-N-E. It's done. And so if you're here and you're like, okay, I think I need to trust Jesus, you're going to respond to his invitation to simply come. You said, I'm coming to you. He doesn't say, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and believe everything in the Bible, and make sure you get your life together, and make sure you da-da-da-da-da. He just says, just come. Come with your questions. Come with your worries. Come with your fears, because I am the foundation that is sufficient for all the pressures that you have. Come to me. If I set you free, you are free indeed. And some of you are here and you need to do that. So that's the time tonight. Just say, God, I trust what you have done for me through your Son. That it is in him that I am made right with you, and there's nothing that I need to do because he's already done it. Stop trying to prove to you and instead begin walking with you. And if that's you, I want you to tell your small group leader that tonight I accepted Christ into my life. With all your doubts, with all your questions, all your fears, tonight I accepted Christ in my life. Okay, that's some of you. Many of you are carrying pressure. And your wrestle is, can you trust Christ with your pressure? And so this is what you'll tend to do. I'll say, can you surrender the weight that you're carrying? You're going to say, I'll try. And here's the reality. If you're carrying something, If I said, I'm going to try to let this go, what does this mean? You don't try to let it go. You either let go or you don't. And for some of you, what you need to do is to stop sort of trying to figure out and just go and be done. And see and trust that He can handle the weight of your life, of your wants, of your desires, of your fears, of your questions, of your purpose. He is most careful with you. So you already probably know what you need to do. And what Jesus did, and we're going to take it in this way. He said, this is my body which is broken for you. This is the sacrifice that took care of your sin. And the blood is the blood of the new covenant. It says there's no more sacrifice is required. Not your sacrifice of doing good things, not an animal sacrifice, not your promises to do good things. There is nothing else required from anyone because it is finished. This is the cup of the new covenant. The old is gone, and there's a new one that has been instituted, and instituted by me. And your trust in me is what seals that. And so we're going to take that and say, God, we can't, but you can. And we're going to, in some way, take our faith, as weak as it might seem in the moment, and we're going to place it upon in you and trust that you will carry the pressure that we feel. And trust that our sins are truly forgiven and they are remembered no more in you. And as you believe that, if you believe that, as you believe that, I want you to take and I want you to eat with me. This is my body. And this is the cup of the new covenant. And one of the cool things about this is the way this would be, and I think I shared this last year or before, whenever, but it's such a cool picture. Because whenever a groom would propose to a bride, the groom wouldn't go and buy a diamond ring and mortgage his house for it. He would just, wouldn't get on one knee and say, hey, will you marry me? Here's a ring. He would go and he would get the cup of the covenant from the Father's cup. He would take the cup and he would walk up to this woman and say, here. And what he was saying is, I want to enter into this covenant with you. Would you be willing to enter into it with me? So what he would say is, he would hand it to her, and all she would do, she wouldn't say yes or no. I suppose if she said no, she would take it from him and throw it in his face. But if she said yes, she would just drink it. And what she was saying is not just yes as a decision, but she said, I'm drinking this into the very deepest parts of who I am, that it is actually becoming me. It's absorbed into who I am, and that's what we're doing here. So if you'll take and drink. If the Son sets you free, you are free indeed. Earlier this week, we sang the song that says, He is Jesus, who would die for a thief, who would bear the weight of my shame. And on that old, rugged cross tree, sin is defeated, and we are free. I want us to sing that as though we have been set free tonight. So, Brian, if you guys will lead us.
Savior, He is Jesus. bear the weight of our shame on that old rugged tree. So defeated we are for real. So defeated we are.
Amen.
So defeated we
to
That was sick. I love it. Hey, here's what I need to do. I need to ask you guys to, in some way, shape, or form, just for a moment, quietly, just have a seat where you are. You might, I know you need to spread out, but we don't want you to go heading back. And I'm gonna sort of close this up just by praying for us, for just God to continue to move in our hearts, in our minds, and our souls as we go home from here. And then I think we can probably talk these guys into doing one more song for us. But before they do, we're just going to take a moment to look back at what happened at Fuse this week. I don't know if you've noticed, but there have been people kind of with cameras and stuff, equipment out and around. So we're going to just take a peek at what God's done. But I want to give you a moment before we see that to just quietly pray. Because obviously, you know, something's going on inside of you right now. And so I just want you to ask God to move in your heart and your mind for whatever it is that he's doing in you. And then I'm going to pray for us. We'll watch a camp recap, and then these guys will take us home. So I'll give you a moment, then I'll close this. Lord, thank you that we can be still for a moment and know that you are God. Thank you, Lord, that we can shout your praises with all that we have. Thank you, God, that we can be in a place with people who love each other, with people who love you. And Lord, we just ask that you help us take what it is that you've done in us this week and take it home with us tomorrow. Lord, for each and every one of us, you have moved in a different way. And so help us see clearly what it is that you want for us to embrace when it comes to our walk with you, Jesus. Thank you so much for just the way that you've worked. Thank you so much for the way that you love us. Thank you for the grace that you extend to us, Lord. And we celebrate who you are and that we can be here. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
You know, we go through a lot to put Fuse together, and I think it's really worth it when you're in the room and you are able to experience what these students are experiencing. I mean, the worship that they are brought into by the band, the music is just amazing. It gives students a chance to really connect with God kind of on a heart level. Just seeing students kind of walk around camp with their peers and with their leaders, building these relationships that they're gonna have for a long, long time, that makes it so worth it. Fuse lives on in their life as a marker of when they really had a chance to grow in their walk with God. And that makes it all worth it. Every year after we get through with Fuse and we kind of step back and we ask the question, is it worth it? Ever since I've been in Port City and people long before me have answered that question yes, because we hear stories of life change. And even if only one student comes to know Jesus and have a true relationship with God, I think it's all worth it. Hope students take away this week really is the awareness and the challenge to think about what they believe. Whenever you get the opportunity to speak to students like this, they're often hearing things that they've heard a lot growing up, whether it be religious things, spiritual things, whatever, and really to challenge them to start making those beliefs their own so it stops being stuff that they've heard and starts becoming stuff they believe. So I'm really pushing into them to help them think about what they believe and be able to articulate why they believe it and not just respond to what they don't believe. Kids in our youth group that are struggling with really significant issues. We've got kids who've lost parents, kids whose parents have split. So you've got all the pressure they feel, and I see that. And just as a pastor, and I think maybe as their pastor in some way, I want to reach out and let them know that they matter and they're cared for and they're loved and they're going to be good. And that sort of pastoral sense, but also the potential to really challenge them to step into who it is that God is calling me and to believe the things, to boldly believe the things that Jesus has promised to us.
Forever young in this love, this freedom's untainted. Don't ever stop.